কিন্তু কোথায় করছে সেটা তো দেখো না, সেটা তো অত ধ্যান করা সম্ভব না।
আসলে আমাদের তো ট্যাক্সেশন নেই না, যে যখন পারবে সে তখন করবে আর কি।
হ্যালো, তো মিউট ইওর অডিও অ্যান্ড মাইক্রোফোন। আই অন বিশ্ব অন বিহাফ অফ বিশ্বভারতী ওয়েলকাম টু অল অফ ইউ। নাও উই আর গোয়িং টু স্টার্ট প্রপোজ সেকেন্ড ন্যাশনাল ওয়েবিনার organized by Vishwavidyalaya Agri Network. You know today's speaker is Professor Bindu Chakraborty, Vice Chancellor, Vishwabharati University, Shanti Niketan. Sir, already joined this program. Good morning, sir. Our university library has joined
this program. May I request the original audio to us?
Please introduce this program. Please, Niketan.
Okay, so good morning. At the very outset, let me welcome all the participants from all over India. And I am very delighted to state that this is our second drive, which is supposed to be in the nature of any university library who is going to organize this kind of event in unique pattern. And it is again having 10 days, 10 sessions lecture. And this session is going to be hosted by our two dearest colleagues, none other than Dr. Tap Kumar Das, Deputy Librarian, and Dr. Sanat Bhattacharya, Senior Assistant Librarian, who is soldiering to carry out this event within very short notice. And as you know, in May, there was some sort of technical problem, and more than 300 participants after registering, we have to take again free registration. And I'm also happy that there is more than 600 registrations from all over India, right from Jammu Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh, and from Mumbai to our, you know, some Tamil Nadu and south part of the India. And I'm also delighted that our today's speaker is our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bidyut Chakraborty, and, you know, who is basically our instance of day-to-day footwork. And when we are just going to propose him, in one sentence, he said, okay, I will be a speaker of this webinar, and definitely I will deliver one lecture on comprehending research methodology. What I am saying is that by this, I don't know how much of the Indian university library has this kind of good fortune that the Honorable Vice Chancellor is agreed to give more than 1 hour time to deliver one lecture, though whole globe and India is under lockdown, by his position and by his chair, Vice Chancellor is not restless. He's always doing work, and administrative work is going on. Given that, his beloved attitude to the library, not only before the library, but by his, in general, his very library-loving attitude, and we are getting so much of support from him. We work in our library network every foot. So with these few words, we don't want to waste much time. And by this way, our last lecture will be staged on 29th of June. And in May, there will be more than total lectures, and content will be infinite. Then library and community development, Tagorean perspective, guidelines and experiences on this, role of libraries in ranking and accreditation of the institution, web-based source of resources for knowledge enhancement, and JAS way to do statistics and online free software, Google tools for teachers for teaching and learning, then EndNote, one web management tool, then Dexter and Grammarly as research assistance tool. This time we are going to open up our new showcase to assist our Indian academics to steer their research in handy and, you know, simple ways to take over our session one webinar, one notification. And those who are not able to join this event, we have already opened our Vishwavidyalaya Library Network YouTube channel. Right from this today's session to end of 10th session, every day, after the completion of the lecture, the speech will be uploaded in our YouTube channel. So may I all share this channel, our thinking, share our perception on research work, throughout India and abroad. But this way, we, on behalf of the Vishwavidyalaya Library Network, library is closed, but librarian is not. So to implement this proverb, this proverb, second step, once again, welcome you. And let me welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to take his part today's session and formally inaugurate this 10-day national webinar by this. Inspector sir, now floor is your opening. Thank you, sir.
Legal rights. One of the natural rights. তো মানুষ হচ্ছে সমাজী, আমরা সকলে যদি সমাজে মানুষ বসবাস করি, মানে কিন্তু একমাত্র সমাজ জীবন যাপন করাই আমাদের মূল উদ্দেশ্য নয়। মানুষের উদ্দেশ্য কি? মানুষের লক্ষ্য হলো এক কল্যাণময় সমৃদ্ধ জীবন, অতি সুন্দরভাবে মানুষ রাষ্ট্রের মধ্যে সংগঠিত হয়, সমাজের মধ্যে সংগঠিত হয়।
Which is a source of inspiration for me, because here I feel that there are two types of individuals who imbibe the spirit of Bhagavan Krishna, and also who didn't participate in the war, yet he ensured victory for the Pandavas. There was another character, who was with the Kaurav. Despite all kinds of temptation, he never left his friend Duryodhana, simply because he believed in the friendship. So as an administrator of this university, I hardly get a chance to interact with my colleagues on academic themes. So when I was asked by our librarian, Dr. Nimai Shaha, whether I could speak on this particular topic, I immediately accepted it with a lot of enthusiasm, simply because it will give me a chance to unfold myself as an academic. The second share is also very interesting, which also I believe very firmly, and I would like to convey this to those who are participating in today's webinar, that if we remember the sense, the spirit in which this particular couplet was written, we'll probably handle so many problems in our life easily. Karam achha hai, कर्म अच्छा है तो किस्मत दासी है, कर्म अच्छा है तो किस्मत दासी है, नियत सही है, नियत सही है तो घर मदीना काशी है, तो घर मदीना काशी है. यू नो द पोएट सेज दैट इफ यू वर्क विथ ऑनेस्टी, इफ यू वर्क विथ हार्ड वर्क, इफ यू वर्क विदाउट motive, then your luck is bound to support you. And if that be the case for pilgrimage, you don't have to go to the centers of pilgrimage, because your home happens to be the pilgrimage if you are honest, if you are truthful, if you are forthright. So I think, you know, with these two shares, I would like to place before you what I am going to speak on. Let me begin with my doubt. You know, I've been told by the organizer to speak in English. But there are many participants who are also from outside Bengal. You know, I'm not comfortable in English because that's not my language. I'm not comfortable in Hindi because that is something which I learned after having spent so many years in Delhi. I am not a Bengali speaker since I didn't stay in Bengal for more than half of my life. So I don't know in which language I am comfortable. And this particular expression, this particular, you know, dilemma, again is expressed by a poet who beautifully wrote a couplet in Urdu saying, Siktoli aage barke, Siktoli aage barke angreji jaban, Siktoli aage barke angreji jaban, dar ki gunga ho jayega Hindustan.
Join hoega chote video shuru hoye geche.
They see, you know, we have learned English very enthusiastically, but as a result, we have paid less attention to our mother tongue. As a result, when we speak in either in Bangla or in Hindi or any of the regional languages, which is our mother tongue, we invariably draw on English expression to articulate our thoughts very clearly. So that shows that, you know, we are not expert in either English or in any of the languages which are considered to be our mother tongue. But still, since English is the link languages in the country, and as per the constitution, it is a link language, and I am trained in English language, so I'll speak in English. I wish I could speak in Bangla, because that I am more comfortable in Bangla than Hindi, than English. But still, since the organizer gave an order to speak in English, I'll stick to that, and I'll honor the instruction given to me by the organizer. What about the topic? You know, I'm not going to talk about research methodology. I'm going to talk about how to comprehend the idea of research methodology. You know, I am one of those old-fashioned academicians who were not trained in the formal training in research methodology. When we studied postgraduate, when we did PhD, even, you know, I got my PhD from one of the foreign universities, but there also we didn't have any course on research methodology. Yet we did PhD. Yet we keep on writing books. Yet we follow a specific kind of methodology which may not have any official name or official identity. So I think, I know I'm very, you know, I'm befuddled. I'm bewildered as to the importance this particular topic has assumed in recent years. I'm not questioning. I'm simply endorsing my point of view that despite not having been trained in research methodology, I write something which makes sense. I write something which is read by my colleagues. I write something which is severely critiqued by my colleagues. So point I'm trying to make that doubt my training in research methodology, I've been able to master the art of putting things in the form of an argument, in the form of a meaningful argument, which makes sense. So I think the first query I'd like to place before you, that is this so important? I'll give a very, you know, very mundane example. Now, in nowadays, I think that's true almost in every household. When any food item is cooked, we invariably tend to draw on YouTube instructions. They obviously, who follow YouTube instructions, they make very palatable stuff, palatable to the preparation. But think of our grandmother, think of our great grandmother, even think of our mother. I'm too old, so my mother, you know, now she survived, she would have been in her 90s. So she also cooked, but she never had to look at YouTube instructions. She did many things for us. She cooked many, many interesting items for us. And, you know, she prepared things on the basis of her own methodology, which she imbibed by being part of the household, which she may have learned from her mother, my grandmother, which she may have learned from her mother-in-law, my dadi. You know, the point I'm trying to make that you don't have to be trained to understand methodology. Research methodology is something which one imbibes by being involved in an activity called development of a meaningful or persuasive argument. Now, the first thing, you know, to understand my perspective, understand my point of view, I think the first task which I'd like to undertake is to de-learn you. Is to, you know that in medicine, if we take a particular medicine regularly, if we take antibiotics on the basis of medication, then we tend to develop resistance to those antibiotics. The doctor, what doctor does, doctor gives medicine to de-intoxicate the patient, then apply the medicine. Here, I'd like to start with that process, that first, let us detoxicate ourselves and to use our social science language, let us de-learn ourselves. And then I'll focus on what I have in mind. Now, when you think of de-learning, you know, look at the text. If you look at the available literature on research methodology, you'll find many books, and especially Americans. Americans are always ahead in injecting the devices of learning their own way to the rest of the world. So if you look at the library, any library for that matter, most of the books written by the American professors. And if you look at those books, you'll find that they're more or less, you know, talking about the same thing in different languages. Because they are source of inspiration, as far as my knowledge goes, as far as my understanding goes, appear to be the same, appear to be identical. You know, what they do? Now, first, if you look at, if you remember any book, pick up any book from the market or from the library, you'll find the authors enumerates some of the ideas based on certain conceptual approach and tend to explain things in terms of those conceptual parameters. Now, let me make things a little easier for you. Most of the books, when they deal with research methodology, they talk about positivism. Now, positivism, as you know, is something which Comte, the French philosopher, French sociologist, developed. Now, in positivism, there are two features. One, that, you know, we can make comments. We can conceive something on the basis of observable facts. Now, sun rises in the east. It's an observable fact. Whenever teachers come, we tend to stand up to show respect. It's an observable fact. When the child grows old, he goes to secondary school, he goes to high school, he goes to colleges. These are observable facts. When there is a social crisis, there are demonstrations, there are agitation. These are observable facts. So if you want to do research, if you want to conceptualize these events, these activities in terms of research, you have to focus on what is visible, what is observable. Now, by that, what is implied here? It's implied that there are certain things which are not observable, which are not visible, cannot be conceived in research parameters. Now, that particular part was taken care of by Durkheim, Charles Durkheim. Charles Durkheim said, yes, there are certain observable facts, but there are certain facts which are not observable, but which exist, which are beyond individual awareness. Now, for instance, you know, I didn't see my great, 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 great grandfather. This is not observable to me. But conceptually, he existed. So Durkheim said, you know, there are many things which happens on the surface of society, have their roots in a world, in a terrain, which is not observable. So Durkheim, in a way, to me, what is called addressed the lacuna or the weaknesses in Kant's understanding. So when you think of research, when you think of methodology, you think in terms of what is called observable facts. Now, when you think of research, what you do? Re means again, search means quest. Again, you are searching. So when you research, when you search again, as far as Kant is concerned, you have to think in terms of observable fact. As far as Durkheim is concerned, you have to think in terms of facts which are also not observable, which is not also beyond individual awareness. Now, you know, if you look at the Sanskrit word for research, I think that will give me a little, you know, what is called clearer understanding of the situation. You know, in Sanskrit we call gobeshana. Now, gobeshana is a word which is a combination of two words. Go eshona. If you look at eshona, eshona means research. Khoja, dhunna. And go means the globe, prithvi. So if you think in terms of searching for things in prithvi, in the world, in the globe, that's research. So, you know, then the point, if you take these two definitions, research English and gobeshana from Sanskrit, you'll find that we are trying to explain these in terms of observable facts and also facts which are beyond individual awareness. Now then, from this, we come to another method, which, you know, they talk about. Critical rationalism. Critical rationalism is something which owes its growth to Karl Popper, the famous book, Open Society and Its Enemies. Now, Karl Popper argues that, you know, we can think of those events, those facts, those areas which are both verifiable and falsifiable. That means, you know, you can see something which you can verify. If suppose, you know, I have a pen. This is the pen I have in my hand. So this is verifiable because pen has a functional quality. It helps you to write. But at the same time, if I get this, then you'll find it's a bottle. So that means, you know, this is not pen. How will you say? Because the pen has a function which bottle doesn't perform. Similarly, a pen cannot be a bottle because pen doesn't perform the function of a bottle. So Karl Popper argues that, you know, we take up only those events, we take up only those situation, which take up only those areas which can be verified and which can be falsified. So research methodology means that, you know, we will focus or will confine our interest, will confine our concern to those areas, to those events which are verifiable and falsifiable. Now, here you'll find there are certain axiomatic things. that you know man is born to die. The sun rises in the morning, sets in the evening. These are all axiomatic things. Now this you cannot neither verify nor falsify. So there are certain areas in human existence which you cannot verify. Furthermore, when we talk, when we you know comprehend, we don't express everything which influenced my comprehension, which influenced my talk, which influenced my thinking. There are a lot of implicit things. There are a lot of hidden things which cannot verify. You cannot verify. Even suppose you know when as an administrator I do certain things, but I do not explain why I did that. I explain something which will be palatable to the person who is listening to me. So that means you know I'm not expressing everything which I have in mind. So if you believe in critical rationalism, you cannot explain my behavior in terms of critical rationality. So there is a lacuna also here. The third thing, the third method, the third what is called ingredient of research methodology from the Western point of view is interpretative design. Interpretative design. What does it mean? It means we interpret in accordance with my priority. Now suppose ideologically I am with X group. So whatever I do, even if the X group does something wrong, I'll interpret it as being most conducive to the goal I am planning to achieve. So interpretation is subjective. It cannot be objective. Interpretation is based on one's social, economic, and political priority. So I'm prejudiced. When you think of interpretive design, I begin with my own concerns. So conceptually, I'm prejudiced. I'm biased. I'm not as objective as I'm expected to be. So to me, the interpretative design doesn't seem to be a perfect one. If you believe in positivism, if you believe in critical rationalism, then I think interpretive design, you know, is way ahead, is way far from both these interpretations. Because interpretation is subject dependent. And the moment you bring in subject, you also bring in subject's predilections, subject's priorities, subject's preferences. So the moment you bring in preferences, you are not actually doing objective research. You become what is called prejudice. So research is prejudice, fair enough. Research cannot be free from prejudice, free from predilections. The fourth one, they argue, they said constructivism. You know, everything is constructed. Society is constructed. Human beings are constructed. Ideas are constructed. So when you think of research methodology, you have to keep it in mind that there is nothing which is called absolute. There is nothing which is called pure. Everything is constructed. Now, this to me appears to be little, you know, acceptable, simply because it gives a chance to the researcher to do things in accordance with his or her priority. Now, you know, I'm interested in Tagore's poems. Now, Tagore as an author, Tagore as a personality, is a combination of many influences. Tagore wrote something in the context of first partition of Bengal, 1905. And that there he wrote certain things which probably you don't find any similarity which he wrote in the 1920s or 1930s. So that means what? That means construction of Tagore's ideas was contingent on the context, social, economic, and political context in which he articulated his thoughts. So he constructed ideas, he constructed his views, he constructed his perception in accordance with the influences which he experienced. So, you know, I'm trying to conceptualize Tagore's ideas in terms of his own priority, in terms of his own perception. So when Tagore wrote a specific piece, when Tagore questioned the formal education or the institutional education of the British time, he must have had some influences on the basis of which he questioned that. Now, had he not that experience, probably he would have appreciated British system of education. So the point I'm making here, that constructivism probably allows us to understand research methodology in a perspective. And I'm going to talk about these little longer in my second part of the presentation. Now, when you think of research, what we have in mind? Now here, you know, I categorized, or I rather divided, research activity, or the activity called research, into four components. The first component to me is description. Description. The second component is co-relational. Co-relational. The third component happens to be explanatory. Explanatory. And the fourth component happens to be exploratory. It comes exploration. It's an attempt to explore. It's called exploratory. Now let me explain. Now, whenever we deal with a particular theme, you know, think of India today. Now you can approach India today first with your description of how India is according to your perception. You can think in terms of COVID-19 and the you know, difficulty we are undergoing. You can think in terms of those who are battling against COVID-19 and coming out victoriously. You can also think that there is a wave being critical of what government does. So you know, there are many ways. So you know, you can describe India of 2020, India of June 2020, in terms of different ways. So you describe. You describe. This is your, what is called, the laboratory. India. India of this type. Okay. The second, you strengthen your argument. You strengthen your description. You, what is called, make your description realistic by reference to link it with India in the past, when there was no COVID-19. So India before March 2020 and India after March 2020, because the lockdown started. So, you know, to understand India beyond March 2020, you may compare, you may correlate to the India that was before March 2020. So it means what? You can see that X was present in March beyond 2020, and X is absent in the post March 2020. So you can make a kind of, you know, correlational argument. That, you know, before COVID-19, you know, we hardly used masks for it, but now we are using masks. Before COVID-19, we hardly maintain, you know, physical distance, which is known as social distance in contemporary parlance. So before March 2020, our social interaction was articulated differently. But now it is articulated in a completely different fashion. So your description becomes far more realistic with reference to this relational statements. So in methodology, we tend to use what is called a relational statement. This is the second part. The third part is explanatory. Now, why do you undertake the research on India today? Simply because we have certain questions in mind. That is, so you know, I'm making a very general kind of an observation. The question which may come to you is India better now? Or is India worse? Is India a better livable place? Or India has become worse livable place? Are Indians now less accommodative than in the past? You know, there are many questions you can ask. So, you know, if you have the question, then you can try to address those questions with reference to your description and correlational statement. So, you know, in research, this is our main objective, that we try to find an explanation. Now, your explanation may not correspond with mine. I may not agree with you. I may question you. I may criticize you. But from your perspective, from your point of view, you have an explanation. So research aims at an explanation regardless of whether that explanation is correct, appropriate, or true. And then finally, from this comes exploration. Now, if you look at the development of political philosophy, we begin with, you know, Plato. We begin with Aristotle. We begin with Rousseau when it comes to democracy. We begin with John Stuart Mill when it comes to liberalism. We begin with Karl Marx when it comes to Marxism. So these thinkers, they did research. They did deal with social, economic, and political reality. They provided an explanation by reference to what I call a relational statement. And at the same time, they also explored. Our thinking, our conceptual parameters evolve over a period of time. These thinkers, Western thinkers, and I'll come to Indian thinkers in a while. These Western thinkers, they started with their research interest. And after some time, they also found an explanation which was not adequate for their ideas to be projected, for their ideas to be articulated. So they went beyond their explanation. And the moment you go beyond your explanation, you come under the category of exploration. Now, this thing happens very clearly in science. That's why we make a distinction between discovery and invention. In social sciences, we do not have that kind of watertight compartments between discovery and invention. But to me, exploration roughly corresponds with invention, if you allow me to use that term. So in social sciences, when you think of research methodology, there are four different steps. The first step, as I call description or descriptive. The second step, I call it co-relational. The third step, I call explanatory. And the final step, I call it exploration. Now, these are by what I call, you know, the attempts or the endeavor to detoxicate it. Now, I'm ready to talk about my own understanding of the situation. Next page. Now I'm putting my, what is called, I'm giving my food to you. It's a kind of, you know, what is called food for thought. As I said, I am an old-fashioned academic. I do not believe in the what is called well-established literature in research methodology, because I still think that you can be a good researcher, you can be a good author without being trained in research methodology. Simply because everybody has got a mechanism, an internal mechanism, an inherent mechanism to devise one's own methodology. But now, you know, I'm trying to understand how it happens. Research methodology to me is certainly a scientific way of looking at the minds of those who contemplate new things on the basis of his or her understanding of the situation. So I use the term research methodology in a very generic sense, not in the American sense, in a very generic sense. So I'll keep using this word in that sense, so please keep that in mind. I mean, don't accuse me of being critical of Western conceptual parameters and at the same time using the Western expression. But I'm not doing that. I'm using research methodology in the generic sense. I'm highlighting it. Okay. Now then, how do I start about it? Now we are what I call detoxicated. And on the, after this detoxication, I'm putting my ideas, my views, my ways of looking at research methodology. Now I start with three guidelines, because I strongly believe a human being, a researcher, is not immune from the context in which he or she is born. You know, I believe the Platonic dictum that every philosopher is a child of his time, which means that the philosopher or the those who conceptualize ideas, they are influenced by the context in which they are born and nurtured. So this is the basic statement I would like to make, and I'd like to develop that statement with reference to certain conceptual ideas. Now, these three guidelines, which to me are fundamental to understand the mindset, to understand the mental, what is called the cerebral complexities of the researcher. What are these? The first one, to me, history speaks. You know, when you look at history, history is not simply the story of the kings, the story of the queens. History is about processes. History is about the specific ways a particular society functions, a particular society evolves, a particular community evolves, a particular idea is germinated and evolves. So when you think of history, I think primarily in terms of history being a process. It can be processes, both. So when I make the statement history speaks, I have in mind the importance of the processes which a researcher should take into account very, very seriously. So you have to base your argument on the basis of historical reality. I mean, if I want to conceptualize Rabindranath Tagore or his ideas in the context of 2020, I may not go anywhere, simply because Tagore wrote his pieces, Tagore articulated his ideas with reference to the context of India between 1861 when he was born and 1941 when he died. So this is the period in which he wrote. So we'll have to understand, we'll have to conceptualize his ideas with reference to that particular context. So when I see history speaks, I have that in mind. The second one, history repeats itself. You know, famous Marxist statement. Now, when Marx talks about this, history repeats itself, or it's a very, you know, well-known diktat. What does it mean? It simply means that, you know, if the process is similar, if the context is similar, human beings, society, will behave more or less similar way. You know, that's why Marx qualified history repeats itself, not the way it happened in the past. He qualified. That means what? You know, I cannot say that COVID-19, simply because of lack of economic activities, will lead to a famine. Now, I cannot explain COVID-19 if it leads to famine in 2020 with reference to what happened in Bengal in 1943. But lack of economic activity, lack of the callousness of the government, or lack of supply, whatever may be the example, the explanation, led to 1943 famine and many millions and millions of people died. So history may repeat in the context of 2020 because of COVID situation. Again, you know, I'm telling this hypothetically. I'm making this, giving this example to make my argument clear. I'm not suggesting that COVID-19 will lead to famine. No, I'm simply giving you an example. When things up, when I'm explaining this particular sentence, history repeats itself. So, you know, there are certain processes which might have occurred in the context of 1940s, which led to 1943 famine, may appear in today's context. If it happens so, then probably famine is likely to develop. So, you know, in this sense, a history articulates itself more or less in a similar fashion in different phases of history. The third point, this is also very interesting, and here I am, you know, drawing on Marx's own writings, that history mirrors transformation. As I said, history repeats, but in not the in the way it happened in the past. That means what? History changes. History transforms. Now think of 1895, plague epidemic. Now, as you know, if you look at Tagore's own writings, plague epidemic was devastating, especially in Bombay, Pune, and Calcutta. Because these are all metropolitan cities at that point of time. And, you know, plague epidemic created not merely physical distance, but in the name of physical distance, it created massive social distance. Those who are affected by plague, they are immediately ostracized. They are immediately banished from society. Wrote extensively against this. You know, when Bal Gangadhar Tilak criticized the British government for not being effective in giving relief to the plague victims, he was immediately arrested under the Sedition Act. And Tagore raised his voice and he wrote a very long essay in Bharati in 1895. At the same time, Tagore was the one who campaigned for vaccine in Calcutta. If you look at the newspapers at that point of time, you'll find that Tagore was on the road to campaign for vaccine against plague and also wanted to raise funds so that he can support those who are victims of plague. Now, why I'm referring to this example? Now, in today's context, you'll find that those who are COVID victims, COVID-19 victims, are ostracized. You know, I belong to a district, Birbhum district, and there I find many cases. Those who are declared, you know, positive, they're ostracized in villages. So, but at the same time, there is a voice. There is a voice against that. You know, I should not tell things which we are doing ourselves. We send, you know, relief every week. And, you know, many of my colleagues are going to the villages, which are also affected, without, you know, any kind of, you know, without being scared. So the point I'm making here, that here is an example, which I'm setting with reference to relational situations or contrasting situation, where I'm showing that history transforms. At one point of time, human beings were so, you know, blind that they actually avoided not the disease, but the human beings who are affected by the disease. No, we are very careful about the disease, true, but not the person who is suffering because of the disease. I think we need to go to him or her. So, you know, that's it, that idea has now evolved. Nowadays, we don't probably behave the way our, you know, former the erstwhile Indians in the late 19th century behave. So, you know, history transforms. Now, you know, if I take these three things together, history speaks, history repeats itself, history transforms, you know, what I have in mind? I have in mind that a researcher, if he or she would like to understand the reality in terms of close to objectivity, he or she should take these ideas into consideration. And by these ideas, you know, I can explain this in terms of the Platonic dictum, which I just mentioned. Every philosopher is a child of his time. So, you know, our main concern is to capture the time. And on the basis of our understanding of the time, we can probably, plausibly, meaningfully explain the reality. So I think this is, to me, the guidelines. Now, how do I develop these guidelines? Here comes the conceptual intervention. Now, in my time. So, you know, here I'm coming to the conceptual intervention. Now, as I said, you know, I'm not xenophobic in my ideas. Don't misunderstand me, because I'm also a product of Western system of education. I'm trying to, you know, evolve a unique way which can be developed on the basis of looking at the Indian or the non-Western reality. So my primary concern is to understand our reality in terms of non-Western conceptual theoretical interventions. But that doesn't mean that I am totally blind to the contribution made by renowned thinkers in the Western social, economic, and political context. When I think of the sources, I have three important conceptual views in mind. Three important conceptual views, to me, are very critical to understand how to evolve research methodology, how to evolve the research parameters. You know, it's just like cooking. It's just like cooking. For cooking, you need certain things. You need all kinds of instruments. You need all kinds of, you know, spices. You also need a mind. So similarly, you know, research is nothing but a cooking. And while cooking or while doing research, you need to draw upon certain conceptual parameters. And these parameters are there. And you use those parameters on the basis of your approach, understanding of the theme. What are those parameters? First, liberalism. The second, Marxism. And third, humanism. Now, let me qualify this. You know, please don't misunderstand me that there is a watertight compartment. among these categories. You know, you'll find Marxists also use liberal tenets. Liberals also use some of the Marxist tenets. Similarly, humanism is something which figure in both liberal thinking and also Marxist thinking. So, you know, to me, these categories or this division is entirely analytical. Because there is a kind of, you know, cross interaction, cross penetration among all these categories. So this is the qualifying statement I made. Now then, when you think of liberalism, what is important here? Now liberalism, as you know, is individual liberty based conceptual approach. Here individual is the parameter, the focal point, the pillar. Liberals, you know, starting from Locke till John Stuart Mill, if you look at Locke's ideas, if you look at Jeremy Bentham's ideas, if you look at James Mill, the father of John Stuart Mill ideas, if you look at John Stuart Mill ideas, you know, I have selected, I mean, there are many. If you look at David Hume, if you look at T.H. Green, so, you know, these are to me, they are broadly classified as liberal thinkers simply because their primary concern is to understand individual, is to understand society from individual point of view. Individual liberty is most important. Individual liberty. You know, Amartya Sen also talks about development as, you know, freedom. His famous book, Development as Freedom. If you deprive individual of certain things, that is what is called unfreedom. Anyway, I'm not going to talk about that, but I'm going to talk about the classical theorists. Now, Locke is important because Locke's primary concern is to understand government, because he believes that the government is the only instrument which will ensure individual liberty as perfectly as possible. So for individual betterment, for protection of individual rights in its most self-gratifying way, government is important. Now, how does government come into being? According to Locke, there are two agreements. The first agreement is to come out from the natural ambience, natural existence of human beings, and then to have an agreement between the individuals who come out with those who are intelligent enough to handle the government, handle the administration. So they call it, you know, fiduciary trust. That I have trust in X, so I'd like to have X as part of the government. So, but the main concern is to have that instrument to ensure maximum good for the individuals. Now then, if you look at, you know, the Rousseau, again another contractualist, Rousseau talks about the general will. Now general will doesn't mean will of everybody. General will means the will which concerns social well-being. So, you know, there's a kind of what is called value judgment. That, you know, if I will for the community, I'll be part of general will. If I will for myself or my tribe, then it will not be general will according to Rousseau. So, but again, the primary concern is to contribute to the individual well-being. So, John Stuart Mill, you know, defines two types of action. One is, they call it self-regarding action. Another, he calls it other-regarding action. Now, self-regarding action means, you know, the actions which are contributing to the self. The other-regarding concern, which is contributing to other, everybody. Now, John Stuart Mill prefers other regarding action simply because he believes, he talks about in detail in his book on liberty and also the representative government, that so long as you are confined to self-regarding action, you cannot think of the development or the well-being of the society as a whole. So you have to shift from self-regarding action to other regarding action. John Stuart Mill. So, you know, the point I'm trying to make that in liberalism, if you want to do research with reference to this conceptual parameter called liberalism, then you have to draw on these ideas. But the primary concern which runs through from the text written by Locke to the text written by John Stuart Mill, individual is the prime. Individual is the main pillar, the principal pillar of your discussion. The second point, second source comes to me as Marxism. Now here, as you know, it starts with Karl Marx, developed by Lenin, developed by Gramsci, developed by Mao, and there are many. But you know, these are all leading exponents. So I'm focusing on them. And so Karl Marx, famous because he talks about dialectics. Is a method. He talks about dialectical materialism. He talks about historical materialism. Now, when you think of dialectics, you know the famous Hegelian dictum, you know, dialectics is nothing but a mechanism of developing one's argument. You know, thesis, then antithesis, there is a battle. There is a kind of conflict between thesis and antithesis, and it evolves, it leads to synthesis. Again, synthesis becomes thesis, it's questioned by antithesis. Again, it leads to synthesis. I mean, that's the process. So, you know, technically speaking, Marx is trying to conceptualize evolution of ideas in terms of contrast, in terms of conflict, or which Hegel calls it dialectics. Now, if you apply this dialectics, Marx would argue that this is, you know, some kind of historical materialism. What does it mean? He argues that, you know, matter, context. If to him, you know, materialism is more important. He doesn't talk about, you know, the heaven. He doesn't talk about God. He doesn't talk about things which are spiritually in existence. For him, the matter is most important, which is, you know, society, globe, human beings. They are very important. And he said, if you look at history, you'll find history moves when the matter, the context changes. And this is, there's a historical evolution from primitive communism to serfdom, from serfdom to feudalism, from feudalism to capitalism, from capitalism to socialism, from socialism to communism. So, you know, it's an evolution. Evolution from primitive communism till communism. That's kind of Marxist, you know, scheme. Now, and the movement, Marx explains, in terms of changes in mode of production and relations of production. Now, mode of production means, you know, how do you produce? If you think of feudalism, plow, bulls. If you think of today's capitalist context, in the machine. And then relations of production, when you produce, you are involved with the landowner and the land dealer. When you think of a factory, the industrialists and the workers. So, you know, he said that when you think in terms of production, you also think in terms of some kind of relations. And when the production changes, relation also changes. So, on the basis of this kind of mechanism, he evolves his own scheme of evolution of society from primitive communism to communism. Now here, when you think of communism, you know, one might argue that it's very unrealistic. He argues state withers away. Now here, you know, he defends states is something which is withering away on the basis of two important principles. The first principle is this administration of men to be replaced by administration of things. It's a very important principle in Marxism. Administration of men to be replaced by administration of things. Now, for instance, you know, in the library, books are stolen. That's true everywhere. Now, if you go to the West, you know, the books has got magnetic tape. So if you go out, the machine will tell you that the books are being stolen. Now, that means what? In India, we still check. So it is administration of men, but in the US, is administration of things. They said, well, that means what? As and when human beings will realize that he or she should not do this, then you don't require any kind of control. Now, for instance, you know, I mean, I come from Delhi, traffic light. There are many cases of drivers jumping red lights. Very often it happens. But there are many people who simply stops when there is red light. I mean, I my experience with Japan, that when there is red light, even if there is no car in miles away, people stop until it is green. So that means what? You know, you condition yourself. When you think in terms of administration of things, Marx had in mind that you condition yourself in such a way so that you don't have to be told. You don't have to be monitored. You don't have to be, you know, asked. That's one. And second principle is that from each according to his ability to each according to his needs. That means what? Now suppose I am 25-year-old young guy, which I am not now. No, I can work for 8-10 hours easily, but I don't have any family. I don't have much responsibility. So I don't need much money. But somebody who is 60 or 65 years old, he cannot work 8 hours. He cannot be as productive as a young one, but he has a big family to maintain. Plus, he needs money for himself, for medication and everything. So Marx argues that the person who needs money, because he also contributed to society when he was young, he should be given more. So that is a, you know, perception. It's a mind perception. So from each according to his ability, you work. To each according to his needs, you get paid. That's the idea. That's what Marx said. Now, these are the things which Marx said now we will not understand, will not appreciate. But probably in course of time, we'll appreciate. Society, there are two types of classes. One, we call it class in itself. Another, we call it class for itself. Now, class in itself, for instance, if I belong to working class, we are class in itself. We are all workers. If we belong to teaching community, we are all teachers. So in terms of class interest, we all are teachers. But the moment we stand out to fight for our rights, then Marx said, you become class for itself. So you're fighting for your rights. Now this was defined and elaborated further by Gramsci. Gramsci made a distinction between political society and civil society. You know, Marx talks about civil society, which he derived from a French thinker who spent about half a year in the United States and then wrote a very famous book called Democracy in America, Alex D. Tocqueville. He talked about civil society at length, but the idea Marx derived essentially from Hegel. Hegel talks about civil society. Now, civil society means what? You know, Hegel argues that between the state and family, there is a space. State is highly public and family is highly private. In between public and private space, there is a space. So for instance, the space of the university is neither family nor state. So Marx Hegel argues this is civil society. This governs both the public space and the private space. Now, Gramsci introduces another concept, political society. He said, yes, civil society sometimes remain indifferent. You know that. I mean, there are many things happening in the country. We as teachers remain indifferent, but we are part of civil society. Krishna argues that when you become involved in social discourse, in social activities, then we become what Ramshi would say, political society. We are fighting for our own rights. So, you know, the point I'm making that, you know, you don't find anything new. It's a different kind of interpretation. And this interpretation happens because Gramsci was writing in the context of the rise of fascism in Italy. He was in jail when he wrote The Prison. And there he was all these ideas. So his understanding of the situation, his understanding of Italian reality led him to evolve this kind of distinction. Now, similarly, Mao, you know, introduced the idea of contradiction, which Marx also did. But Mao's contribution is that there are, you know, contradiction is of two types: antagonistic contradiction and non-antagonistic contradiction. Now, non-antagonistic contradiction, now suppose, you know, as teacher, we may have differences between assistant professor and associate professor. We may have difference between associate professor and professor, though we belong to the same community. So Mao would argue, this difference is non-antagonistic. But teachers versus, you know, suppose, you know, a group of people who would like to capture Vishwabharat, then we fight. You see, it is our space. So we'll have to fight for it. We need to counter the opposition as a united force. So here Mao would argue this antagonistic contribution. He argues that, you know, in the context of socialist revolution, the contradiction is between the workers and the industrialists. This is antagonistic. But the contradiction in the context of socialist revolution between bourgeoisie and the petty bourgeoisie, this is not antagonistic, it's contradictory, this non-antagonistic. So, you know, the point I am trying to make that these are all ways of looking at things. So a researcher should look into all these intricacies to understand social reality from the Marxist point of view. You know, if I had time, I could have elaborated, but now I'm coming to humanism. Now, humanism, here I have in mind two Indian thinkers, Gandhiji and Rabindranath Tagore. Now, Gandhiji, as you know, was not a theoretician. And if you look at Gandhi's writings, you know, you find many contradictions. He wrote something in the context of 1910, for instance, first decade of the 20th century. And you don't find any compatibility between what he wrote in the first decade of 20th century and the second decade of 20th century. And Gandhi was asked again and again. So Gandhi said, you see, first of all, I said I have become old. And secondly, he said, I don't remember. When I write things, I don't remember what I wrote in the past. And also he said, you know, I have evolved. I evolved. I thought something which was good, say, 10 years ago. But on the basis of my understanding of the social reality, I think, no, that was not correct. Now, Gandhiji, those who are interested to understand Gandhian methodology, I would urge upon you to read two books. One, Satyagraha in South Africa. Another, the Hind Swaraj. Now, Satyagraha in South Africa is essentially a movement book. As you know, he led Satyagraha in South Africa during his stay between 1893 to 1914, roughly 21 years. That particular book contains how he evolved the idea of Satyagraha, how he led the Satyagraha campaign, and what sort of difficulties he underwent. So I think that particular book will give you his perception, his way of mobilizing people, his way of conceptualizing people, his way of handling contradiction in the context of a campaign. So researchers who are interested in understanding a particular movement from the Gandhian point of view can be benefited immensely with reference to that particular book. Then comes Hindswaraj. Now Hindswaraj, as you know, is a booklet. And he wrote while he was coming from England to South Africa, Liverpool to Durban. It's a 13 days voyage, 13 days journey. And in those 13 days, he scribbled 30,000 words. And these 30,000 words were published in the form of a book called the Hindswaraj or Indian Homebrew. And the story goes that Gandhiji used both his hands so that he, you know, doesn't forget the ideas which are coming to him. And also the story, he wrote this particular book in response to the questions he faced in London by Savarkar and his friends who talked about violence. Gandhi said no non-violence. So he defended. But it's basically a very, you know, scathing critique of Western civilization. Now you'll be surprised to know, I mean, this is very important in today's context, the Gandhiji questioned railway. Now it's surprising, because Gandhiji was very scientific in his perception. Then why did he question railway? He questioned medical science also in Hindswaraj. Now railway, I mean, that is very important in today's context, very relevant to today's context. Now he questioned railway because, as I said, he had in mind the outbreak of bubonic plague in India then in 1895. Then he argues that, you know, because of railway, which was the fastest mode of transport then, so most of those who are affected by bubonic plague belong to various parts of the country. But the moment they were affected, they wanted to come back home. So because of their, you know, transfer from one place to another by the fastest mode of transport, railway, bubonic plague spread throughout the country. But that is what is happening now. When you think of, you know, outbreak of COVID-19, we always condemn the migrant labor. And migrant labor, they are coming sometime by aeroplane, sometime by train. So you see, so the foresight. Gandhi wrote this book in 1909 with reference to 1895 plague, and the same thing is being repeated in 2020, more than 100 years after Gandhi wrote the Hindswaraj. Medical science, he questioned medical science. Again, that's very surprising. Gandhi was one of the modern minds of contemporary India. Why did he question medical science? Gandhi questioned medical science. He said, because of medical science, we forgot to practice self-accountability. Now, he explained in a very interesting way. He said, now, when you go to a wedding, for instance, or to a restaurant, we tend to overeat. And we know that even if there is stomach upset tomorrow, we can go to the doctor. And doctor give me medicine and I'll be okay. So what I lack is self-accountability. If there is no doctor, then I would not have overeaten. So he said, because of the presence of the doctor, you know, we forgot self-accountability. So, you know, both these ideas I am putting forward, that Gandhi was trying to understand human beings from this perspective. Now, then his understanding of society is also very unique. He argues the society or life, human life, is not pyramid. Human life is oceanic circle. What does it mean? Now, a pyramid means what? The pyramid is a kind of, you know, what is called a triangle, where the top controls the bottom. And here Gandhiji had in mind the British bureaucracy, that everything is controlled from Britain. So it's pyramidic structure of administration, which Gandhi opposed. Human beings, the common Indians, had no role to play. So he evolved Panchayati Raj. Now this Panchayati Raj, he conceptually explained as oceanic circle. Now, what does oceanic circle mean? Now, think of an ocean. Now, when you see an ocean, the water is horizontal all over. You find any hierarchy, then you can say that India, Bay of Bengal is little higher than what you see in Mauritius. So it's the horizontal. And secondly, he said that if you look at ocean, you'll find different kinds of life. You'll find big whale, you'll find small fish. There's a coexistence. That coexistence is peaceful coexistence. So with this idea of oceanic circle, Gandhi was trying to conceptualize society as free from hierarchy, as hierarchy free. And secondly, as something which is based on peaceful coexistence, right? So, you know, the point I'm trying to make here, that this is Gandhian way of looking at society. So a researcher, if you'd like to do research in the Gandhian mold, then probably he can be benefited with reference to this conceptual parameter. Now let me come to Tagore. Now Tagore, as I said, you know, I can talk on hours together. I mean, I after having taken over this responsibility, I'm reading Tagore, you know, is far, far more versatile, far, far more instructive than what is available, what is known to us now. Tagore needs to be explored further. If you look at his Tagore's writing, one third is verse and two third is prose. And you know, both verse and prose are dialectically interconnected. But you know, I don't want to, you know, spend much of time because, you know, this is not on Tagore. But I just would like to pick up certain ideas so that that can be of help in conceptualizing research question and also in dealing with contemporary human society. So here I would like to draw your attention to certain texts. Not many, I mean, there are many texts which I can refer to, but there are two important texts in the form of novel, which I think very critical to understand his approach to human society. I would first talk about Raktokorobi. Now, Raktokorobi is a figurative kind of play. Now, Raktokorobi is a story of a king who is not visible. Raktokorobi is the story of Nandini, who is full of life. Raktokorobi is the story of Ranjan, who is so bold to question, to say anything which he feels like. Raktokorobi is also the story of a collection of people who are working in gold mines. Now, you know, there are many characters, but what is the main theme? The main theme is two. First, the idea of freedom. Raktokorobi is a challenge to a system in which freedom is muzzled, in which freedom is withdrawn. This is one idea which runs the play. And the second idea, Raktokorobi is also a story of challenge, opposition, struggle. And finally, which is little tangential, Raktokorobi is also a story of transformation. The king comes out. As I said in third, history mirrors transformation. So to me, if you want to understand Tagore's methodology, Raktokorobi is figurative, you know, the story is about, I told you, the characters. But the underlying theme happens to be freedom and opposition and challenge. And the tangential theme happens to be transformation, change, metamorphosis, revolution, you can say. Right? So this is the first part. The second part is Gora. Now Gora, you know, is probably the one very thick book. I brought the book, thick book. Now Gora is basically a story of transformation of someone who was born to Irish parents, nurtured by a very orthodox Brahmin family, and then finally he realized that he was born to Irish parents. And then his transformation. But you know, that's the kind of storyline. I'm not interested in storyline. I'm interested in the theme. Now, Raktakarabi talks about freedom and challenge. And I find the same theme recurring in Gora. I'll give you a very concrete reference. If you go through the novel, you'll find, I think after one third of the novel, Gora comes out of Calcutta and goes to a village, and there he sees India, the real India. And there he found that as a Brahmin, he was asked to stay overnight with somebody who is Brahmin, Madhav Chatterjee. But there he saw that there is a family of Barbar, a Hindu family of Barbar, who is looking after a Muslim child, Faru's son, Tamij. Now Gora was surprised that why the villagers are insisting on his taking the hospitality of this particular Brahmin. And he said, well, you are Brahmin, you are upper caste, I think you should not go anywhere else but to Madhav Chatterjee's place. But Madhav Chatterjee is the one who was essentially a supporter of the British, who was responsible for putting Tamid's father, Faru, in jail. So he's a bad man. He's a bad human being. So Gora said, why should I go there? See the dilemma in Tagore. Because Tagore at one level is reflecting the social prejudices of that particular period. He's not coming out openly, but he's putting the question. But at the same time, at the heart of heart, he's not happy. He wants Gora to go to Barbar's house. But because of social pressure, social context, Rabindranath cannot say it categorically. But by raising these kind of issues, he repeated what he said in Raktakarabi, that I am interested in freedom and I am also interested in challenging the conventional ideas. Right? Now, then I refer to one small poem and one song. This is my favorite song, one of the favorite songs of Tagore. The crisis situation makes Tagore very sensitive to the reality. You know, he suffered because of his, because of the death of all his children except the eldest one. He suffered because of the conspiracy of those who in a way supported him to build Vishwabharati Shantiniketan. He suffered because he has some different opinion with those who are in support of Zamindari. So, he had what is called several, dimensions in life, which were reflected in his text, in his writings. So this particular song, he said, Ami marer shagor padi debo, bisham jhorer bahe, amar bhoy bhangar nai. I'll cross the ocean of opposition, and I'm not scared of the veracity of the danger, because the ocean is very disturbed because of typhoon, but this typhoon is not scary to me. I have got that courage to cross this typhoon and go to a place where it's free from typhoon, free from trouble, free from disturbances. So this particular song again, reiterates the point I made, freedom and challenge. And then finally, Bharat Tirtho. Now Bharat Tirtho, if you look at, I don't have, time to recite the entire poem. To me, this particular poem has three different dimensions. The first one is trying to create a space where there will be no hierarchy. Gandhian oceanic circle. I want to create a space where everybody is welcoming to everybody, regardless of his or her religious identity, caste identity, or economic identity. So this is a society, a space, Bharat Tirtho. Ei Bharater Mohamanober Sagore Tire. I'd like to recite this part. Esho he Arjo, esho Anarjo, Hindu Musalman, esho esho aaj tumi Ingraj, esho esho Khristan, esho Brahmon, shuchi kore mon, dhoro hat sabakar, esho he potit, hok aponit, shob apoman bhar. Now to me, this is a very, very, poignant articulation of accommodating everybody, regardless of class, caste, and ethnicity. He's welcome everybody, even Ingraj. He said, here I find the similarity between Gandhi and Tagore, that Gandhi never conceived the British as enemy. He said, British government is my enemy. Yeah, okay, but not the British. So when he welcomes Arjo Anarjo, so he's questioning the racism. When he welcomes Hindu Musalman, he is questioning religious division. When he welcomes Brahmon or Brahmon, he is questioning caste division. Right? So that means he is trying to build a society which is free from hierarchy, which is free from prejudices. So, friends, I think, I'm coming to the end of my lecture. Now I'm trying to compress. And I would like to remind you the guidelines. History speaks, history repeats itself, history mirrors transformation. And these three guidelines help me understand the sources. And you'll find that all the thinkers who helped us understand social, economic, political reality, they are guided by certain priorities. And all of them, they come under one umbrella simply because they are interested in understanding the idea of freedom and its expansion. One, they are also trying to devise a mechanism to achieve freedom or unfreedom. The distinction between freedom and unfreedom needs to be blurred, needs to be eradicated. And in order to do that, they are thinking in terms of what I call challenge. So challenge is something which you will find with regard to all the thinkers. Now I think this is briefly speaking, my approach to research methodology, that instead of focusing on what is written, what is well publicized by the American intellectuals in terms of research methodology, I would urge upon those researchers, even researcher means not merely PhD scholars, even those who write books, to focus on the contextual priorities and to understand those contextual peculiarities. We have got many what is called conceptual influences, conceptual parameters, which will help us understand the reality better. Now, with this, I come to the formal lecture. But as I said, I love doing Sher Shayari. So I'll end with one Sher, which is again one of my favorites. Prahlad jaisa viswaso, Prahlad jaisa viswaso, Sabari jaisa aasho. Prahlad jaisa, Prahlad had tremendous faith in God. God exists everywhere. Sabari, the Ramayana character, she waited for Ram for so many years. Hope, aas means hope. Draupadi jaisa pukar ho. Draupadi always called for Krishna. And that famous scene when she was disrobed, it was Krishna who helped her. So Draupadi jaisa pukar ho. Meera jaisa intizar ho. Meera waited for Krishna, but Krishna never came. Meera jaisa intizar ho. So Krishna ko aana hi padta hai. If you have all these things, in our research, concerned, Prahlad has a faith like Prahlad's, hope like Savari, call, invitation, which I find in Draupadi, and waiting, which we find in case of Meera. If that happens, then I think the goal will be achieved very conveniently. I'm thankful to all of you for having listened to me this long lecture, probably most boring lecture. And also I request all of you to stay safe, to stay fit by maintaining physical distance, but remain socially connected. Only then we'll be able to cross over the COVID-19 difficulty happily and conveniently. Thank you very much. All the best. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. Really.
Very insightful deliberation on the topic of community discussion. Many things, I think all the participants should agree with me. Particularly to me, I have come to know the research methodology in new perception, because before this lecture, my understanding was research methodology is a kind of what sir is saying, not a proposition, but that was understanding to me. But today I understood that this is the repetition, it should be not performing, and many things that with a long experience and practical experience try to comprehend the research technology, what actually research technology is. And by research activity, he wants to propagate description, relational, explanatory, and exploratory. And if I'm going to make sort some up of this, then it will take time. I'm not going on that. I do not consider myself as having a full-fledged life to sum up that kind of valuable thing. But anything, I have learned that class in itself and class for itself is a very kind of academic body we are saying this thing is synonym. But today I found this is very different thing, and we have just tried to not able to understand what actually is. Then political society, civil society, this is again another thing. And then we have just time to equate this today's COVID-19 situation along with 1895 plague situation when there was a pandemic, and what was the kind of this development. It is just integrated over today's society that
on behalf of you all, let me request our Vice Chancellor sir to deliver one lecture on a particular political science subject, maybe on Gandhi and other things, because audience are very interested to listen to him on other topics. And next month, we will talk to you to have this kind of one more informative and fascinating lecture for the better society. Now, we are here for both of the Samus Madhukari and Dr. Samus Madhukari to pick up some subject questions, to have some appointment spoke to our audience. If they want to know something, please request them to unmute themselves and ask the questions that is kind enough to give answer. Or you can pick up some questions from the chat box to say something to be correct instead. I to six questions, we may not pick back more than that. Okay. Thank you, Hamza and Abhutha to pick up the question. Thank you, sir.
चेकबॉक्स की
सेशन इज ओवर और इट इज कंटिन्यूइंग
क्वेश्चन थे क्या बोलो
মিটিং আছে একটু
Good afternoon, sir. Can I ask a doubt to Dr. Vidyut Chakrabarty? Good afternoon, Dr. Vidyut Chakrabarty.
Hello. All are requested to unmute your video and audio, please. Please unmute your video to take the session picture. Please unmute your video, take the session picture.
ওড়াটা উদিত মানে
ঠিক আছে